Okay, recording. Yep.
So, because of course, you know, when we have meetings, we generally are working with a group of people or a team of people to achieve certain outcomes. We're still looking here at learning outcome 3, at your effective interpersonal communication skills in business. And this is about participating, sharing, recording meetings. Are any of you part of a trust, or do you attend any other regular meetings through the course of your work? Or
Yeah, I do.
What kind of meetings do you go to?
So, a few boards.
Yeah, good. Okay.
Yeah, so one is at the DHB.
Yeah.
And then I've got a few sort of voluntary ones.
Voluntary ones as well?
Yeah.
Getting busy?
Yeah.
Good. All right.
Well,
I went to assembly today. You went to assembly? Well, that's a really focused meeting. I'm sure you'll be starting to be included in staff meetings.
Yeah, first one Thursday. So.
First one Thursday, correct. Good for you. Jodie?
Yeah, I've been here. We've got the informal meetings.
What's it, informal meetings?
Awards committee and like the union, actually.
Yeah, some formal meetings as well. Yep. Union meetings. Policy
procedures, type
meetings.
Ethan? Yeah, union meetings, PSIs, and informal like morning meetings to discuss today's work plan.
Exactly. Yep. Okay, good. So there's daily ones as well. Jen? Not really. Not so much.
Summer?
Not so much.
I'm, as of this past Monday, I'm the chairman of the Cranbourne Community Control, so I'll be basically leading those meetings.
You'll be chair. Excellent. So let's find out what we need to be able to do in order to do that. You guys probably do attend more informally. It's your applied management group. That's a kind of a meeting, you know, like you're getting together, everybody's got a purpose. It's just more of an informal type meeting. So there are a few textbook distinguishes between different types of meetings, and it does affect, you know, how that meeting is run and structured a little bit. You know, if it's an informal meeting, then you may not even have somebody taking minutes, or you may not follow a sort of really prescribed format in terms of how that meeting is managed and prepared or presented. You know, the difference between, I'm the secretary for the Jill McBride Trust, and you know, how that meeting is run in comparison to maybe how a meeting government is run, it's completely different in terms of the level of formality required. Yeah. We have, you know, personal meetings. So we meet for personal reasons, friends, relatives, whatever, versus professional meetings. Okay, so again, it's going to affect the type of information that you put across and the interpersonal relationships that exchanges that happen in that situation. Scheduled or unscheduled. So you might have, you know, like a daily scheduled meeting at, you know, 8:30 when everyone arrives at work. Or it might just be that, you know, people impromptu meet together in the atrium or in the staff room or in the cafe to have a wee chat about something in particular. So again, that's also going to impact on the level of formality. Private versus public. Is the information that's being discussed public information, or is it private? Okay, so for example, I think our academic boards are supposed to be public meetings that are open to the public, is that right? And the council meetings are open to the public, except for they can exclude certain parts that could be, you know. So that affects the privacy in terms of information that's put across at those meetings. And if they need to have a sort of a private section where they might not disclose other information that wouldn't be made public. Public exclusion, that's right. Small or large, the number. What was the optimal group size that we talked about last week?
Five to seven?
Yeah. So if you start to have a meeting larger than that, it's difficult for people to contribute and put in their ideas. Are they regular meetings or one-off? Okay. So, you know, again, that's going to affect how these meetings run. If they're regular, then there's usually a prescribed some format, expected behaviours, and this is it's usually quite routine. For a one-off meeting, it might be a little bit more uncertain as to how that meeting is managed and chaired. And then, obviously, we've got mediated by technology versus face-to-face. Okay, so now, for example, here we've got, like I said, campuses in Auckland and Christchurch and Wanaka and all over the show, Riften. Whenever we have a meeting, we always have somebody on video conference zooming in. So, you know, that affects making sure that they've got access to all the information. It's at a suitable time. The facilities are all booked. There's a lot of organising that goes on in managing sort of mediated meetings as well. And that's common, you know, if you're looking at international business, being able to use that technology to facilitate that is fantastic, if you can make it work. And of course, good versus bad meetings. Well, how do we define a bad meeting?
Well, it goes on longer than an hour.
Why longer than an hour? Longer than the actual prescribed time.
These classes go on for longer than an hour.
These classes are scheduled for 2 hours, so you're lucky when they finish early. Have a look at the exercise, page 335, and perhaps discuss this in pairs.
They can talk more when they have given
it. Yeah, you don't mind.
mind if it runs over 50.
So a good meeting might have some refreshments.
Yeah.
That's not bad. Maybe good running half the time, like finishes quickly, you don't get as much discuss.
Okay, good. So you don't, well, you might think that the chair may have moved things on too quickly without enough opportunity for discussion or ideas, yeah.
Yeah, somebody taking over the whole meeting and no one else getting a say.
Someone dominating, yeah.
That's sort of the chair's role.
Yeah.
Exactly, that's right.
Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. When we start to talk about what is the chair's role, it's really important that your chair is reasonably skilled in their ability to manage
the governance.
Yeah, people, manage the conversation, be able to, you know, move people on, stick to the agenda. Ethan, did you have anything?
Yeah, poorly constructed PowerPoints.
Poor PowerPoints, okay, yeah. So if there's presentations involved.
What about in a noisy environment?
Noise or distractions?
Lack of knowledge, like the chairman or the person discussing issues has lack of knowledge on the matter.
Okay, lack of knowledge, good.
What
about
late at the end of a busy day where
not
everyone switched on?
Timing.
Poor timing. Yeah. Actually thinking about when are we going to hold a meeting so
Friday
that
night.
The maximum number of people can be engaged in it. Something in particular that made a good meeting that, you know, I mean, obviously the opposite of all of those things, but was there anything else that you thought of that stood out for a good meeting that you've been to?
Structure.
Yeah, structure.
The good ones that I, like the DHB, they send you know, the agenda like a week before, so you've got a whole week to process what the information's about.
Preparation and planning, yeah.
Yeah.
So you get your agenda a week in advance, you can read all the documents beforehand.
Having a good chair.
Good chair.
Yeah. So good knowledge, you know, they've got knowledge, Because obviously, you know, once again, like with the DHB one, you've got a strict time management.
Yeah.
So you've got to have good chair to be able to move people on from there.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Have that good feedback after, so you know, like you'll get the minutes given to you.
Good, yeah. So you actually get feedback, so you receive the minutes in a timely fashion. There might be action points in there that are clear and easy for everybody to follow, and everybody sticks to them and does what they're supposed to do. Okay, good. Okay, have a read of the case study handout, activity one. Helpfully titled The Unproductive Meeting. Okay, how did we get on? I'm thinking about Holly's thought. At least we communicated, thought Holly.
Did
you go back to our models of communication and our, you know, idea of creating shared meaning? Is there shared meaning coming out of the situation? Christopher wasn't even listening, so what's he going to take away? She really wants him to improve his performance.
Mm.
Is he going to take that on board in this situation?
She could be discussing that in the last meeting anyway.
Exactly. Is that the appropriate place to discuss that? The all staff meeting. What sort of role was Christopher actually playing in that meeting?
Distraction, annoying.
If you go back to what we talked about last week, and we talked about functional versus dysfunctional. Yeah, so he's playing a sort of dysfunctional, destructive role within the team. Yeah, he's not only is he not engaging, but he's actually distracting from the core purpose of the meeting quite deliberately. And also, if it ain't broke, don't fix it. So he's blocking our change, you know? So if you were Holly, there's lots of things I think here that Holly could have done differently. What did you come up with? Summer, what did you think?
Just be more organised.
Be more organised, okay. A bit more planning preparation. Jen?
Make it a formal meeting.
A formal meeting, yeah, that's right. She's actually got some quite important things to discuss. Why have an informal meeting? Jodie?
Yeah, so plan an agenda, set the time and a time limit.
Agenda, time frame, time limit. Good. Aaron?
Offer refreshments.
Offer refreshments! Yeah,
yeah.
Yeah.
See everyone wants to go.
Christopher might be happy. Hey, if this is the first meeting back and everybody's been on annual vacations, it might be a chance
an informal meeting,
people
so, yeah.
get together again, and you know, why not offer a few muffins or something?
I think that she shouldn't have been doing it. She should have been doing cheer and secretary.
No, yeah, okay. Really difficult to cheer and take the minutes at the same
That's
time.
That's why it took 9 minutes.
That's why it took 9 minutes. Yeah. Ethan, did you have anything?
Play a more assertive cheer role.
Like
so.
What
does it mean by a minute? I don't even know what. By minutes, does it mean like jotting down the information within the meeting?
Good question. Yes, absolutely. Minutes are the written record of a meeting. Okay, so some meetings you will take minutes, some meetings you won't take minutes. It depends on, you know, do we need a record of this for the future? And so, especially in a formal meeting, there's always usually minutes.
That's what you get when you run in the meeting.
After the meeting, it's the summary of the core points in the meeting. It's not a word-by-word detail of what everybody said, now Christopher said, and then Holly said back. That's not the purpose of the minutes. The purpose of the minutes is to provide a clear, succinct sort of summary of what topics were discussed and what were the key action points as a result of that.
In order of the agenda.
Yeah, so the agenda lays out what is the order of the topics that we're going to talk about, what do we need to get through, what's the time frame, and then the minutes basically align to the agenda, so then you just fill in, you know, what was discussed. Decision points. Zane, did you have anything?
Most of what's been mentioned, but arrange the room a bit better, because maybe that could have
facilitated better communication. She even reflected on that beforehand. The boardroom's not ideal for a meeting, but it's only going to last 30 to 40 minutes, so it doesn't really matter too much anyway. Well, it's a bit of a mistake.
Maybe we should have had a different room if the boardroom wasn't suited for an informal meeting.
Yeah. And she's got quite a few people, 12 staff members, so it's a bigger group, so she needs a bit more space. Everybody needs the opportunity to be able to share their ideas. Okay, good. So that's raised a few key points regarding, you know, meetings and how they're managed. We'll look at them in a bit more depth now. There's a wee bit there in your textbook about just thinking about the different objectives that you're hoping to achieve out of meetings, and usually that's around what are our goals, getting people to communicate. We want to foster people's participation, contribution, get ideas from people, or maybe share information to people. So that's the purpose of getting all these people in the same room. Otherwise, we could just do it via email, right? If it's simply to disseminate information, we can just do that via email. But if it's important and we want to make sure that people are getting the message, then a face-to-face meeting is going to give it a bit more. We're going to make sure to see that those people are there, that they're taking that message on board, and we get the opportunity to have feedback and input and discussion. Okay, so we can have, we can discuss decisions that are going to be made and who's going to take action in regards to certain tasks that need to be completed. Okay, so it's really, I don't know, that was a bit of a running joke, but if you're not at the meeting, you get lots of action points put against your name, right? that's just that idea of if you want to be involved in the decisions, be at the meetings. 39% there's a study that they did. 39% of professionals say that they have dozed off at some point in time during a meeting. Now, I don't know if you'd get away with that in some of our smaller organisations and smaller meetings, but there you go, there's the statistics. We don't want our meetings to be boring where people are dozing off. We want to encourage participation. So we want to develop appropriate norms for behaviour. And last week we talked about that team development process of forming, storming, norming, performing. Well, norming is about developing those as rules for engagement within the group. So just in your textbook, page 337 there, norms or rules for meetings. Each different scenario is perhaps going to have different norms regarding this. Is it expected that everybody attends? Is it okay to submit apologies? What is the duration? Is there a expected time frame? Place, do you always meet in the same place? What about personal norms, your appearance, your posture, your participation, body language? That sends a sort of message in terms of how engaged you are in the meeting. Communication, who's talking, who leads, are people allowed to interrupt or not allowed to interrupt? In some formal meetings there are very strict rules as to what you're allowed to say, when you're allowed to interrupt, when you're not allowed to interrupt. Google Robert's Rules of Order for parliamentary meetings and have a look at what you're allowed to do and not allowed to do. It's a minefield, I tell you. I don't know how those politicians get it right. It's probably not, but anyway. Robert's Rules of Order was a book that was published in like 1940, even earlier, I think. It was published a long, long time ago, and it's still around, and it's still republished in different editions. But it gives a really strict rules and order for managing meetings, if you're interested. Most of the books in our library are things like this nice little one, How to Manage Meetings, and it doesn't cover a lot of the formal stuff. But the rules, the formal rules, are out there if you're interested. Social norms, do we get together outside of the meeting? Do we socialise? Do we get to know each other? Or is it purely that we only meet for this particular purpose and then we disperse? And work norms, who sets the work agenda? Who decides? What are the procedures for making decisions? Do we have to vote, or is it by consensus? How do we decide the action points for the meeting? So think about your different meetings that you might go to. Do they have quite different norms and expectations?
Yeah. Yeah? Yeah. So the DHB one is very structured.
Yeah.
And obviously, maybe about or sometimes BC, so 12-ish.
Yeah.
Yeah, so obviously, you know, go through whatever the gender is and have a discussion. And obviously, if you've got some sort of input, then you've got to go to the chair. And can I speak through? Madam Chair?
Yeah, Madam Chair.
Yeah.
Speak.
Yeah.
Yeah,
so you can't just go, oh, by the way, I want to blah, 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 blah. Yeah, because you'll get told off. Yeah.
So you follow strict sort of rules in terms of engagement with the whole group.
Yeah. And obviously if you've got anything that's not in the agenda, then that's called general business, which is at the end of the meeting.
That's why you have to hold it to the general business section at the end of the meeting.
Yeah.
It is a bit of a minefield. Like if you're new to going to meetings, you think, oh, you know, I'll just pipe up and say what I think. That, you know,